Welcome to you all, and thank you so much for joining us on Malaïka, the talk show for Christian African women. And today, please stay with us as we get into our topic. So today we're talking about Christian couples and godly sexuality. And with me, I have the beautiful Mama Audrey. Thank you for being with us, Mama.
Thank you so much, Roz.
And Auntie Zods, beautiful as always. Thank you for being with us today.
Always a pleasure to be here.
And Jackie, thank you for being with us on the show today.
My pleasure.
And viewers, we have with us a guest whom you will meet later on in the show. This is a very interesting topic, and it'll be interesting to hear what all of our hosts have to share with us today. And before we go into depth with that, let's just hear Jackie's overview. So Jackie, we're very excited to hear what you have to share with us today. This is a very interesting topic.
It is indeed. So to kick it off, I'll start with the definition. In the Hebrew, there's a word called yada, which actually means to know. And when used in the Bible, it's a euphemism, which it's a milder term for the word intercourse.
Okay.
The word intercourse in English refers to communication. The special knowledge and the language that's conveyed between a husband and a wife. So it's actually something that happens without words.
Okay.
A special language conveyed without words. I have a few quotes. There's a man called William Penn, born in the 17th century, but listen to his quotation because it's still relevant today. He says, in marriage, do thou be wise, prefer the person before money, virtue before beauty, the mind before the body, then thou has a wife, a friend, a companion, and a second self. Second quotation I have says, a young love is a flame, very pretty, often very hot and fierce, but still light and flickering. The older the love is, its more disciplined heart, it becomes coal, which burns deep and is unquenchable. It's an American writer called Henry Ward. I have a few statistics now. Yes. Firstly, infidelity, which is a big thing in terms of godly sexuality. Yeah. Daily Life 2017, mm-hmm. a newspaper, they interviewed 10,000 married people in 30 African countries. And this is what they came up with. They saw that 70% confirmed that they have had extramarital affairs.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
And across Africa, this is confirmed by a sex health worker who works in Africa. They say that 58% men, 51% women have had an extramarital affair.
Yeah.
The countries with the least husbands, this is in Africa, that have had with cheating husbands, we have Egypt, Morocco, and Libya, all of them having below 50% mm-hmm. of a cheating rate. Let's go to South Africa now. 1,200 people were interviewed in South Africa. This is very high, wait for it. 97% confirmed yes to the question of cheating. So that is enormously high.
Yeah. Very high.
Nigeria had 88%. Zambia, 87%. This is enormous, guys. This is not just kids play, hey? Mm. This is big stuff. Most of the people, respondents from South Africa, they said they cheat because they don't have intimacy in their marriage. The second factor they gave, which is a very high factor, they said because they lack self-control. Oof. That's why they're cheaters.
Okay.
Lastly, I have a quotation from a Ghanaian actress. Her name is Lydia. She says, we've been brought up in a culture to accept that it's in the man's DNA to cheat. We don't like it or accept it. She goes on to say, in our culture, women are not vocal. Women are not supposed to be hurt by these actions. That ends my point.
It's very sad interesting at the same time to hear what our overview has. But in Southern Africa, I'm sure there's more interesting things that are taking place on the ground. Auntie Zods, what do you have to share with us in light of that?
I think the first thing I'm going to say is that this subject is really a hot subject.
Hot.
Very hot. In fact, I think I'll have
spicy.
Burning.
I have to repent to my mother.
It's hot.
I'm about to say things my mother doesn't let me talk about. But in reality, in Africa, we don't discuss these things.
That's true.
There is this taboo. It's you don't say those things. You don't talk about it. Yeah. It's a secret. And as a result, what happens is that many young people grow up without any guidance, mm-hmm. whether it's from a Christian background or just from general society, we don't talk about it. So what does a young person do? One of the biggest influences in this is the voice of the world, because when a young person is about to get married, it's in our tradition to throw a kitchen party, kitchen tea for her, or when she's about to have a baby, we have baby showers. But what we have seen over the years is that these kitchen teas have become so influential, because it's no longer just about giving that gift. Mm. Afterwards, they do what they call the training session for a young girl to be taught how to please her man. And by the way, let's be honest, it's all about the men in Africa.
Yeah.
Every girl's dream is to please her husband, to make him happy. So very little to do about how she actually feels. So with these kitchen teas, it has brought a worldly perspective of the sexual act, which is not godly.
Yes.
And it's not just kitchen teas, there's Stockfels as well.
Yes.
And they're all in the name of, it's a good idea and very good thing that happens, but what has been added to it actually doesn't help a godly woman.
A worldly flavor.
Exactly. Yes.
Today we have with us a very special guest, Stella from South Africa, a pastor's wife, mother of three. Stella, thank you for being with us. And so Stella, we've heard what we're talking about today. When you were about to get married, did you have someone who was actually teaching you on what to do on the marriage bed?
Yes, Rose. Growing up as a young girl, the responsibility of teaching or preparing a young girl rests with the aunt, typically your father's sister or your father's cousin. So from a young age, I had an aunt coming home, sharing with us her experiences, sharing with us how to prepare, what to expect. And through that, I gained a lot of information. I also had sisters and cousins just before I got married who also gave me their perspectives and also shared with me what they'd been through and what they'd experienced. And I was fortunate enough that the ladies at church, they hosted a kitchen tea for me that where they shared and, you know, helped me, you know, to understand what Christian marriage was and, you know, what certainly how to prepare. And I think that was a very good eye-opener, because it also gave me, you know, some of their experiences and, you know, gave me very solid advice. So I would say that, you know, those are the main sources of information that I got. Naturally, as a young person, you talk to friends now and again, you read a book, you do some research on the internet. So I went through all those various aspects and got various information from various different sources.
So Stella, now fast forward to you being married. Did all these things that you actually got have any impact whatsoever on your marriage bed? Did it benefit you anything?
Rose, I would say that there were a few things that do apply naturally. You know, it's good to be prepared. But one thing that I've realized is that each experience is unique. I think, you know, people can share their experiences with you, but ultimately what you experience is unique to your couple. I think what I've realized is that a lot of the things that, you know, I was taught or that I knew ended up being head knowledge. But when it came really to the point of being intimate with my husband, it needed to be just him and I. We needed to find, you know, a way together. We needed to make our own, you know, journey, and we needed to find each other. And I think, you know, a sexual relationship is very unique to a couple. And what you put into that, what you put into your couple, what you put into your relationship, you know, is an overflow of everything that you experience together. So whilst, yes, I think there was you know, room to receive advice, I think a lot of what I now know, I experienced, you know, as I went along. And I think that, yes, you can be prepared, or you can, you know, people can assist you in terms of their experiences and telling you how to prepare. But I think in everything, you know, as you grow, as you experience each other, as you develop your relationship with one another, then naturally your sexual relationship also develops. It also grows. It also matures. And that's what I've realized. So a lot of it has come between what, you know, the relationship that my husband and I have built over the time that we've been married.
Stella, thank you so much for sharing your testimony with us today. And so, Mama, in light of everything we've heard today, who then should be sharing with women about the marriage bed?
I think that that responsibility first comes to the mother. She's the one, in fact, it's a great opportunity for her to build a relationship with a girl, with a young girl, or I suppose not the young boy, that would be maybe the father. But for the young girl, definitely it's the mother. And unfortunately, we see today that this responsibility has, like they've passed the baton to the schools and to the church. We see today that schools are teaching sexual subjects from the age of 3-4 years old. And we've seen terrible consequences on little girls that have been shocked, that fainted because they were shown the opposite sex in a blunt way and they couldn't handle it. And they have just given up that responsibility. And today, as we heard, some people hear it in tea parties, some people hear it at school, but the real responsible is a mom. You know, depending on the relationship you've got with a young couple, especially in our church, we are very close to our people. We have a family church. And it does happen to me when the boy is kissing to say goodbye, I just whisper in his ear, hey, you know, you don't need to rush. You know, we do say that these things again before, but on the last day, I remind him, you know, don't rush. Don't burn stages. Take your time, because you've got all your life. Because we've seen very often girls being hurt and put off. Because the boy wanted everything that once. And I mean, it might be painful, they were not a bit sensitive, and some of them are blocked for a long time, and then they don't even want to hear about that sexual relationship. So it's good to, over and above the mother's advice, we can put in a little word here and there, like we help them before their marriage about their finance, about their the way they should run their home, not being run by the family. The marriage is a, we do, but on the sexual life, it's a bit delicate. We do have it, but you can't go into minor details. These are things that the mom must explain, that the girl must expect. It's normal, but we can't give that responsibility to the world and to education, for people to give us sexual education, to take care of that sensitive subject, especially that today they speak about genders, about all kinds of possible marriage. If we don't teach our kids the right way, they will learn the worldly way, but somebody else will teach them. So personally, I believe this is a key role that the mom is given, that she should be taking early, because today kids are very smart. They are born like Adam, you know, adults. And they are so smart. We must start early, and there are books, Christian books, that can help us. If we are embarrassed, I mean, we swallow our pride, and we help our little girl, and we do that road with her.
And so, you, as you were saying, Mama, that, you know, there's things to be taught, because there's so many things out there. Among the so many things, there's sexual toys, there's sexy lingerie, there's sexual positions, there's sexual this, there's sexual that. What is permissible in the marriage bed?
Okay, we must remember we're Christians. We are not of this world. We are in this world, but not of this world. What would Jesus teach in his days is what he would teach today. The couple, I think, is something very precious in the eyes of God. I think it's a relationship. In fact, Jesus speaks about that relationship as a relationship of the church with him. he speaks about the way the husband must love his wife. Mm. So I don't think that should be something to be endured, especially in Africa, where it is supposed to be the pleasure of the men. No, I think God has created the sexual act for both the woman and the men to enjoy. And I don't believe that they need to use sexual toys or whatever you're saying. But there's a freedom in the couple that concerns them. But whatever they do, they must be at peace in their heart. That is nothing to do with perversion. Mm-hmm. It has nothing to do with inspiration from pornography. Mm-hmm. Nothing to do with things coming from the world and from maybe their workmates mm-hmm. that are experiencing mm-hmm. and trying to become better. I know a story when we did Malaïka in French mm-hmm. of a couple in West Africa. They were subscribing to a porn site.
A Christian couple?
Yeah.
Really?
A Christian couple. And they were learning. Because we heard that Jackie said two reasons is not enough satisfaction in yes. their sexual life yes. lack of self-control.
Yeah.
And they were probably in the first case scenario. And they went on internet and in a porn site. And they were trying to do, but it never worked.
Yes.
Because it's something that must come. It's an intimate, like Sarah said, the intimacy with the husband.
Yeah.
Yes. And I think it's something that they don't speak about. I think the girl should be able to tell her husband, I mean, you know, you're going too fast. Yes. I'm hurting.
Yes.
I mean, take time. You know, as a husband, you should take time to prepare his wife
mm.
for her to be ready mm-hmm. to get the same satisfaction as he will get out of the sexual act.
Mm.
And I remember there was a young boy who came and said he was disappointed. His wife was not so keen. So when my husband asked him, but how many times a week? He said, no, only once every day. My husband said, listen.
Didn't expect no, that answer.
Come on. You know,
that's much, isn't
an
it?
Object. You know, exactly. Your wife has got feelings. Exactly. She must desire. Mm-hmm. She can be tired. She's got a menstruation. She's got periods. You've got respect. She works.
Yeah.
She's got the right not to want. You must mm-hmm. respect these things.
Yes.
So we must be reasonable and be responsible.
Exactly, Mama. And you mentioned something about men that always want to be satisfied and not the woman. And on that note, I think I'll take you to Auntie Zots to give us info in Southern Africa. What is happening then? I believe that's something that happens with domineering men. How does that happen then in Southern Africa when it comes to Christian couples?
You know, I think it's as Jackie mentioned in the beginning, infidelity. It is a big problem. It's like a cancer. It's just growing everywhere. And what it's doing is that for women, it breeds an insecurity because you are so afraid that my husband is going to go out there.
Mm-hmm.
So let me please him whatever at whatever cost to me.
Yeah.
So she doesn't mind. She will accept to watch the pornography, though it may not be what she wants.
Yeah.
I mean, like you are talking about, there's a lady who was saying her husband also wants every day. And it's that same scenario. But now the woman feels compelled because there's a fear that my husband will have a small house if I don't do anything. So with that regard, because the man is the domineering figure in Africa, even as young girls, we brought up to feel that to please your man is the ultimate achievement.
You are nearly born for that.
That's it. That's your purpose. Actually, it's like he feels it's his right.
His right.
And even when it comes to men's infidelity, it is accepted in society. A man can have a small house and he can have another one there. It is not a problem.
Yeah, but here, Auntie Zods, we're not speaking of the world here.
No.
We are addressing the church.
We are talking about the church today.
This is and all what happening is outside the church. It's nowhere outside.
We're talking about what is actually happening in the church as well.
Yes.
Because I will remind you, there's a sister I was talking to. She's a leader in a church. She was saying there's a brother who came asking, can I bring my small house to church?
No.
So we have, you know, so the reality
in house. Laughing, but that's very sad. That is alarming.
Yeah. Yes, that is the state. So for that domineering figure of a man, it really puts the woman at a place where she feels she must submit.
Yes.
But I'll just go quickly on the flip side. Women also have become clever. they're now using sex as a tool. So they will withdraw and not be willing to give in to him so that they can have
their bargains.
It's a bargain.
It's a tool.
So on the one hand, it's a demand. On the other hand, it's like, okay, I'll use it for my benefit. Mm-hmm. So you find that sex is no longer what God intended it to be. And I think it would be so good to have a clear picture of what the plan of the Lord was, because it's so perverse now that even the church doesn't really know where to draw the line.
You know, the Bible is very clear. In Hebrews 13, verse 4, it says, marriage should be honored by all.
Yes.
All means the church, means the leadership of the church, means the brothers and sisters. We should honor the marriage in our communities. And the marriage bed kept pure.
Yeah.
For God will judge the adulterer and all the sexually immoral.
Mm.
I mean, there's a cost to sin. The wages of sin is death.
Mm-hmm.
There's a price, and there is consequences to adultery.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. There are consequences to living an impure sexual life and not having the fear of God in the way we treat our wives, with the way we live our own sexual lives, because there's a judgment. Mm-hmm. And when I hear you about what's happening in the church, I'm saying to myself, you know, when we see the judgment of God on the world, you know, God is not so much concerned so much by the world as much as he's concerned by
the church.
Yes.
Exactly.
And, you know, God reacted when Israel went into sin, not because all the nations around worshipped idols, but when Israel started worshipping idols, that triggered the hand of God to bring judgment.
Mm-hmm.
And when we hear that, we shouldn't be surprised to see God's judgment fall on the church, because the family is the most important cell of society. And if that is not respected, and if that is not godly, I mean, the basic recommendations to an elder, he must be the husband of one wife.
Yes. Exactly.
I mean, that's the basic condition.
Mm.
And he must be faithful. So if at this level already things are happening, I mean, what can we expect now for the rest of the church?
Yeah.
And what model does the world have?
Yes.
It's a license to go in any kind of direction.
But we have that flip side, whereas we have another one, where there's the lack of sex in marriage, where actually the husband is not giving sex to the wife, or the wife is not giving sex, not for any blackmail or whatever, but just there's nothing. How should a Christian then respond to a lack of sex in marriage?
No, but it is very clear in the Word of God. They should need help. They should seek for help, because the Bible, Paul is very clear about the wife. The body of the wife belongs to the husband.
Mm-hmm.
The body of the husband belongs to the wife. It is in 1 Corinthians 7:1-4.
Mm-hmm.
And he said that they shouldn't deprive themselves for too long, except if it's for prayer and fasting, because otherwise they will fall into temptation of the devil.
Exactly.
So if you've got a problem,
we
must know some of these things happen for a reason.
Mm-hmm.
You know, for instance, I know a girl in one of our churches. She was petrified of marriage because she had been through a divorce. Her parents had gone through a divorce.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
And probably there was violence from the father to the mother. So for her, the sexual act, the thought of getting married would scare her.
Mm-hmm.
And one day she shared it, and we prayed with her.
Mm.
And I must say that today she's happily married.
Mm.
Okay.
The Lord healed her. The Lord set her free. So there can be reasons, but whatever reason is, Jesus is alive. And he's there to heal our couple, to heal our relationship, to help us in whatever area we need help, and it can be in that help, unless he's a eunuch. This I don't know.
that's something.
Well, then shouldn't a eunuch not be married, actually?
And you know, I must add that some of the young people today, after going through a hard, difficult, violent couple, like the girl, would not want to hear about a man, because they've seen so much violence with them, their mother, and they turn up to homosexuality.
Yes.
It's often a consequence of the environment, and they say, God created me that way. No,
yes.
God never created anybody that way, but we must go back to the world. We must go back to the basics of the Bible,
exactly.
To what Jesus teaches, to what the apostles has been teaching. This is the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ,
yes.
And that will put our homes, our couples, in line with whatever the Lord has as a plan for us, because it's a good plan.
So, Mama Audrey, just to clarify, you said they need to seek help. How then are you meaning that they need to seek help in their lack of sex in marriage?
You know, the church is meant to be a family. You know, we should be open and transparent to share our problems, our struggles. That is what makes the difference between the church and the world. Exactly. The world goes to see psychiatrists and psychologists.
Yes.
We go to see our pastors, our leaders, the wife of our pastor, people that we trust, that we can share our lives with.
Yes.
And then we can share our problems and share our struggles. And they might give us practical advices, or we might even share with a doctor, with our family doctor. Maybe there's a physical
condition.
Physical condition.
Exactly.
Maybe the husband's got problems, he's a diabetic, and I don't know, he's got high blood pressure and he's got problem in his own life.
Yeah.
And so it can be a medical condition or it can be a spiritual condition.
Mm.
So we need, I mean, this is why it seems so important to have relationship, that the church is not a place where we go, we sit, we listen, we live. We should build relationship, we should know our pastor, we should know his wife, and hopefully they can be trusted. If they've got no one to turn to, they can always turn to Malaika, they can write to us, we can pass the message to my husband, to the team. If it's a girl, she wants to share a problem, by all means.
Yes,
but we don't stay stuck.
Yeah.
Because there are solutions, and there's no shame in that. You know, anybody can have a problem in his life, in any area of his life, and he must be free to share it freely and with the right intention to look for help. Yeah. And maybe the husband needs to be calmed down, or the wife needs to be stirred up.
Hello, can work both ways.
Whatever it is, sometimes there's rebellion in the woman. There's rebellion, she doesn't want to hear this thing of giving herself. But whatever it is,
it can be
there is a solution
when
it is dealt with the right way.
I think that's very clear, Mama. And I want to go back on your other point as well, that we should always go back to the Word. And the Word says God made sex to be a beautiful thing. So now how should Christians view sex in marriage? Because it's been distorted, it's been made perverse. So now how should it be viewed in a Christian couple?
Yes, not like the world portrays it.
No.
It's something very honorable, I think very deep. It's the closest the couple can get to each other. And this is why it shouldn't be treated lightly and like, you know, being an object to be satisfied, because very often I hear, like in French Africa, I've had testimonies of the woman having nothing to do. It's just a matter of penetration, in, out, done, happy.
Finished.
It's not what God has intended. This is something very important. It speaks of the unity of the wife, of the woman, the unity of God with the church. It speaks of so many things which are deep, which is a time for him to know his wife, to love his wife. It's a time of tenderness. It's a time of affection. It's a time of privacy.
Yes.
And I think God has intended that for a special, enjoyable time for a couple. Not for the joy of sin and the pleasures of sin and the feelings that it can give you, and which at the end of the day, there's a high price to pay for.
Mama, thank you very much. And unfortunately, we have to end it here today,
yes.
Ladies. But thank you so much, all of you, for your time and for being with us today. And viewers, we are so happy that you stayed with us till the end of the program. And I know you benefited much. And I know somewhere, as we stay close to God, He will lead us, He will direct us, and that's for married couples. Remember that at all times. And so if you want to join us next time, we'll be right here, same time. And remember, if you want to follow us or if you want to contact us, you will find us on Facebook or YouTube on the links at the bottom of the screen. So stay blessed, and we'll see you again next time. Thank you. Bye-bye.